Grace and peace to you in the name of the risen Christ. Good morning, Cathedral of Hope.
Good morning.
It is a joy as always, every single Sunday, to welcome each and every one of you to worship as we gather in friendship, in fellowship, and to find the power of the Holy Spirit in our lives. We're so glad that each and every one of you is here this morning.
And we know we have some first-time guests this morning and also some first-time mother guests, so we want to extend you a very special welcome. We're glad that you're here, and if you have time after the service, please stop by the Ministry Center. We have a gift to give to you just to say thanks for being with us today.
As always, we extend a very, very special welcome to all those who are worshiping online with us. There are many people all around the world who consider Cathedral of Hope their spiritual home. And so we are always glad that you are here with us and present. And so we want to welcome you, especially this morning. Let's welcome them, Cathedral of Hope. Amen. Inside your weekly, you will find all of the announcements for church this morning and for the upcoming week. So please do avail yourself of all of the information. It's a way in which we continue to build community here at Cathedral of Hope. And we want to just highlight a few of those announcements for you this morning. First of all, if you would turn with me to, I believe it's page 7, you will see the advertisement for Dance with the Sun, which is a play that has been running here for this weekend. Yesterday, there was almost a full house at the Interfaith Peace Chapel, and it will be running again this afternoon at 2:30. We really want to encourage you to be a part of that and to witness this incredible experience of sharing the way in which a mother and her son reconciled their faith and her son's sexuality. It really is an important piece, and so we want to invite you to be here this afternoon at 2:30.
And we have Stella and Scott with us this morning. If you would mind standing just for a moment, we want to welcome you and say thank you for being here with us today.
You know, it really is a small world, Reverend Todd. Yesterday when they were here, my husband Isaiah was on the campus, and they looked at one another and said, "Good grief, I think we know each other." And both of them had performed in the Rocky Horror Show in New York many, many years ago. So good to make that connection.
And we also want to welcome Scott's partner, Brian, and Jenny, the director of the play. So we again thank you for being with us. Also, Blooming Ball is coming up this weekend, and we invite you to participate if you're able to go on Saturday night. And especially want to thank Stephen Pace. Stephen has been the executive director for this amazing, amazing organization for many years and a longtime member of Cathedral of Hope. So we give you thanks, Stephen, for all your leadership. And this year, they are honoring you. And so we just celebrate the works you have done for many, many years in HIV and AIDS work. And as Neil says, when he receives an award, we all get an award. So we celebrate that with you.
I really sincerely mean that, and thank you for supporting this incredible ministry that we have here in Dallas and around the world. This morning, we are reminding ourselves of the great partnership that we have with the Maple Lawn Elementary School, which is the school just across the way off of our campus. We've had a long-term relationship with them, and we've been asked to help with some of the underserved kids in that school as they look for clothing and look for uniforms as they think about the end of term and then going back in the summer. You can find out more information about that on page 7 of your weekly. But this morning, we're just giving a very brief challenge. We were looking for 65 people today to help sponsor a uniform for one of those students. 13 of those were sponsored last evening at the couples group, and then another 50 of those were sponsored by the 9 o'clock congregation. So we only need 10 more people who would sponsor a child, and we have fulfilled our requirement. So if you would join with me and with Reverend Todd, that's 8 people now. So if you would see Bruce in the narthex following worship, we can fulfill that requirement and make sure that all children, those who are underserved, get everything that they desire. Isn't that a great thing that we get to do, Cathedral
Amen.
Of Hope? Thank you.
Amen. I want to invite you to join myself along with my good friend Dr. Keith Bernardo for a class called Soul Science. This is going to be an interactive conversation. We're going to be looking at Brené Brown's book, The Gift of Imperfections, and we invite you to join us on Tuesdays for 4 weeks in the Interfaith Peace Chapel for a class called Soul Science.
It really is going to be an amazing conversation, so we want to encourage you to be there. We also want to let you know that we have been chosen again this year as a beneficiary of the Life Walk, so you'll be hearing much more about that in the coming weeks, but we're so grateful for the way in which we get to minister, especially with those living with HIV and with AIDS complications, both in our own congregation, but also here in Dallas. And most of that money that we raise, about 85% of that, comes back to our own benevolence funds here at the Cathedral, and then we're able to make grants to those living in our community. So please do look out for those sponsoring opportunities and think about Life Walk later on this year.
So much going on as always, and with the Holy Ghost coming next week, and I hear coming this week as well. Pentecost is next Sunday, so you don't want to miss it, right, Pastor?
You really don't want to miss it. It's an extraordinary experience here at Cathedral of Hope. If you've ever been to a Pentecost service here, it's a way of acknowledging the birthday of the church and, of course, the gift of the Holy Spirit, although we're focusing on the Holy Spirit throughout May. So make sure you come next week, bring a friend with you, and who knows, we might have cannons and fire and all sorts
Tongues.
Of things.
You never know what might
here
happen.
Here at Cathedral of Hope.
And in that hope, let's rise and tell our neighbor hello this morning.
God, our mother and giver of life, we gather as your holy family to celebrate your love. Send your Holy Spirit upon us and help us to receive your so many gifts. Amen. Please be seated.
Our epistle lesson is from the 8th chapter of Paul's letter to the church in Rome. Hear these words. We know that the whole creation groans and suffers the pains of childbirth together until now. And not only this, but also we ourselves, having the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves groan within ourselves, waiting eagerly for our adoption as children, the redemption of our body. For in hope we have been saved, but hope that is seen is not hope, for who hopes for what one already sees? But if we hope for what we do not see, with perseverance we wait eagerly for it. The Spirit, too, comes to help us in our weakness, for we don't know how to pray as we should. But the Spirit expresses our plea with groanings too deep for words. And God, who knows everything in our hearts, knows perfectly well what the Spirit is saying, because her intercessions for God's holy people are made according to the mind of God. May God bless the hearing of these ancient words. Amen.
So today is Mothering Sunday, Mother's Day. In the United Kingdom, Mother's Day is in March, and so my mom gets two Mother's Days. Only because I can never remember it when it's in March. It's an opportunity for us to give thanks to those who mother us. It's also a time for us to remember those who are no longer present with us, especially those who have served as mothers or in that mothering relationship with us, because we know that mothers come in many different genders and gender identities. It's also an opportunity for us to remember those who did not have a good relationship with their mom. And today we have a wonderful example of a way in which a relationship between a mom and a son has been reconciled, but we know that that is not always the case. So for some of us, we come with pain on our hearts this morning, and we pray always for that abiding resolution and for that abiding reconciliation, that one day that we might all be reunited in that sense of peace and love. So wherever you are on that journey, know that you are being held in the palm of God's hand this morning, and that God is with you. And for those of you who have been our surrogate mums, thank you. Thank you for being there with us and standing alongside us in our journeys together.
Amen. So at this time, we would love to invite the mothers in this room and the mother figures in this room, if you would please come forward so that we can give you a gift, just a token of our appreciation of your love and your spirit that sustains us all.
Appreciation for those who have mothered us and those who continue to mother us, whether they have given birth or whether they are giving birth and giving life. Let's raise out a hand of blessing and thanksgiving and affirmation as we ask God to bless each and every person in this place and those who have been moms and continue to be moms. Thank you that we can celebrate moms. And thank you that you gave them a special responsibility in this world and in this life. Now be with us, God, as we honor them and honor those who have gone before us, honor those who have a less than wonderful experience with their mom. May we stand in the gap for those and enable them to know that there is unconditional love available through the mothering God that we believe in at Cathedral of Hope. Blessings upon them. Amen. Let's give them our sense of appreciation and thanks.
Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church.
Come, Holy Spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, O God.
Jesus replied, "Anyone who loves me will obey my teaching. My Abba God will love them, and we will come to them and make our home with them. Anyone who does not love me will not obey my teaching. These words you hear are not my own. They belong to Abba God who sent me. All this I have spoken while still with you. But the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom Abba God will send in my name, will teach you all things and will remind you of everything I have said to you. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled and do not be afraid. You heard me say, I am going away and I am coming back to you. If you love me, you would be glad that I am going to Abba God, for Abba is greater than I. I have told you now before it happens, so that when it does happen, you will believe. This is the gospel of hope.
Praise to you, Creator, Christ, and Holy Spirit.
Thank you.
to be seated, and if you would open your hearts and minds and direct them towards the God who is with us as we pray. Let us pray. God of grace and God of glory, God who is with us as we worship this day, help us to open our hearts and minds so that we may be channels of the good news that you have revealed for us in Jesus. And through that good news and through the values that Jesus expressed in his life, enable us to be imitators of Christ, to be those hands and those feet, to be the voices of transformation and change, so that we might begin that process of living and making heaven here on earth. Now, God, as we open ourselves, transform our ears and our hearts so that they may be those agents of change. And so I ask now, O God, that you would touch my lips of clay. Mold them into the words that need to be spoken this day, and may the words that come from my mouth and the meditations on each and every one of our hearts, may they be ever acceptable to you. In the name of Jesus, amen. So here at Cathedral of Hope, we are celebrating the Holy Spirit. Throughout this entire month of May, we are experiencing and thinking about the effect of the Holy Spirit, not only on the church, not only on those who were the forerunners for the Christian faith, but we're experiencing and then coming to an understanding of what the gift of that Holy Spirit is for us today, both personally and as a congregation. We are taking this whole season of May, which is also the season of Pentecost. And Pentecost is next Sunday, and so next Sunday we'll experience and reveal that wonderful scripture from Acts 2 that tells the great story of the Pentecost, that first moment when those disciples, when they were in that upper room, and the Holy Spirit came upon them, and there were tongues of fire, and they began to speak in all different kinds of tongues, and the room couldn't contain them, and they ran out into the streets. No, that's next week's sermon. Today we are thinking about the power of the Holy Spirit. That Holy Spirit that was present in that upper room, but that same Spirit that wasn't just present in that upper room, that Spirit that was present long, long before Jesus, long, long before the early disciples, long, long before, in fact, that same Spirit that was present at the very birthing of creation. That Spirit that brooded over the heavens and over the earth and that divided the land and the seas, that same Spirit that soared in the sky and became birds, and that same Spirit that created vegetation upon the earth, the same Spirit that was present even in the groanings of birth pains that the writer to the early church in the book of Romans speaks to us of. That mothering Spirit that gave birth at the very beginning of all of time and has seen her way, weaving its way through the history of humankind. That power of the Spirit that, yes, was powerful on that day of Pentecost, but that powerful Spirit that shaped the earth and created humankind. That power of the Spirit that has transformed humanity over and over again. Every time it felt as if humanity had come to the end of its rope, the Holy Spirit would descend one more time and bring reformation, would bring transformation, would inspire leaders and peoples and nations to think again about where they are on their own spiritual journeys. That power of the Holy Spirit that enables us in our weakness sometimes to be even more than we thought we could be. That Holy Spirit that was present with those disciples and with Jesus, that Holy Spirit that gave power and authority to the disciples as they were sent out two by two, the 72, into every part of the land and given the authority to lay hands on people and to heal the sick. The power of the Holy Spirit that takes the groanings of our own lives and make something good of them. How many of us have felt that groaning of the Holy Spirit in our own time? That Holy Spirit that wants to bring to this earth and to this world a transformed gospel of good news, a transformed gospel of affirmation for all of God's people. It seems that in our own day and time, we need a good dosing of the power of the Holy Spirit to change some hearts and minds, to change some of the ways of the world, to change God's people from those who are just sitting around waiting for somebody else to do what you and I have been called to do. You see, the power of the Holy Spirit is that power that reinforces for us today that we are no longer just the ordinary people of God, but we are the extraordinary people of God. That power of the Holy Spirit that takes who we are in the frailty, the weakness, whatever it is that we experience of our own humanity, and says that you can do even greater things than me, as Jesus would say. And if Jesus was able to raise people from the dead, what would it be like if we were truly to grasp the power of the Holy Spirit in our lives today? What would it be like if we were to really embrace the power that has been given to us as the people of God, the faithful ones, and bring about a revolution in our world? Oh, I know it sounds very 60s. But I truly believe our world is in need of a revolution. A power, a dosing of the Holy Spirit that would transform us into the people that God would want us to be. The power that lies within each and every one of us if we would but just release that power in our lives. I think we have been sold short on the good news of Jesus. We have been sold short in that we have seen the power of the Holy Spirit usually only in just one way. That one way that it was manifest in that upper room that I'll preach on next Sunday. But that power of the Holy Spirit that would send those frightened disciples out into the world to speak in different kinds of tongues. And many of us have come from the traditions that say that the only way that the Holy Spirit shows up is in the speaking of tongues and in the huge arena of the healings that we see in the world. But the Gospels tell us that the Holy Spirit is available in the same way that Jesus in our Gospel today spoke to those early believers and said, "Peace I give to you." You see, the power of the Holy Spirit isn't just in the hoopla. The power of the Holy Spirit is in the peace that we offer to one another. It is that peace that passes all understanding, that keeps our hearts and minds in the knowledge of God. It is that peace that Jesus shared with his disciples in this gospel when he was preparing to leave this earth and go back to heaven. Jesus said to his disciples, "Peace be with you, and peace I leave with you. For I go to prepare a place for you, and an advocate, a helper, the Holy One, will come so that you might be all that you are called to be." And that gift is the Holy Spirit. It is that gift of peace that we offer to one another. It is that gift of revolution that we offer just by being in love with one another. That is the most awesome piece of the power of the Holy Spirit. It confronts the wise of this world and says it's not all about razzmatazz, but it's about the way in which we engage in each other's lives. It's about the peace that we offer across borders and across boundaries. It is the peace that we offer when we don't understand one another. It is the peace that we offer one another when our world tells us that we should be enemies and not friends. It is the peace that we offer one another when we would rather be at each other's throats. And today we hear rhetoric after rhetoric after rhetoric that encourages us not to be people of peace, but to be people of war. The gift of the Holy Spirit in all of its complexity is one of peace. And it's one that enables us to sit at the table together, one with the other, in all of our differences and in all of our uniquenesses, and builds bridges of fellowship and love. When you look around us at Cathedral of Hope this day, you wonder why God would bring together such an incredible motley crew. That's a spiritual term. But the truth is that there is such diversity in this place this morning. There is diversity of gender and gender expression and gender identity. There is diversity of color and race and class. There is diversity in so many different ways, so many layers. And in a world where churches are so homogenous, they are so confronted by just being one thing, one size fits all, Cathedral of Hope breaks all of those barriers and of those stereotypes, and yet there is still more for us to do. But God has brought together this incredible group of people, and God has brought together a group who have such diverse theologies. Believe me, if we were to go around this room today, there would be as many theologies in here as there are people, and maybe a few more. We all have our own way of understanding God, knowing God, seeing God, believing in God. We have those who believe that the way that the Holy Spirit comes is just by the manifestation of tongues, and then there are those who believe that that is the way that the Holy Spirit doesn't show up today. And yet we are all able to be in the same room together because we have found and harnessed the power of the Holy Spirit that breathes into this place this morning and says, "Peace be with you. I may not understand you. I may not agree with you. I may not even like you, but peace be with you." Or as we might say in Texas, bless your heart. It's like speaking in tongues, if I'm a... You see, it is that power that we get to harness as we come together as the people of God, and it is a power that transforms our humanity. It transcends our humanity. For our humanity has the way of making sure that there is these over here and others over there. But the peace be with you, that Holy Spirit, that power that we get to embrace as people of faith, encourage us. In fact, it commands us to build bridges of reconciliation and grace. It's something that we don't do naturally, but it is something that is supernatural. It is that power of the Holy Spirit. And we get to live that out every single week, every single time we come together, and we live it out when we begin to see beyond ourselves to the great commandment of Jesus to enable all of God's people to find this good news. Not just those who sit in the pews of Cathedral of Hope on a Sunday or those who watch us on the internet, but rather the ways of peace that will ultimately bring about a revolution of the Christian church. As many of you know, a couple of weeks ago, I was in New York. It's so good you have to name it twice, New York, New York. And in New York, I was able to have the great opportunity to sit with about 40 leaders from the Christian church at Union Theological Seminary. It was my first time in New York. Never been to New York in all of the years that I've been in America, and it was an amazing experience. I went to Stonewall Inn and paid homage. If any of you have been to the Stonewall Inn, I was surprised how tiny that stage was. No wonder the drag queens were fighting. Wasn't room for one of me, yet alone all of them. But anyway, it was a wonderful opportunity to pay homage to those who have been in the fight for longer than I have. But at Union Theological Seminary, we sat as progressive leaders of the church, having a conversation with each other about how we can build bridges in the Christian community, that there is some truth that perhaps God's LGBTQITSSGLAQQ and all the other letters of the alphabet that we keep adding, that perhaps there was some truth that we have been called for such a time as this. That for many of us who have been in the struggle and who have lived our experience the way those who have had to try to find peace with Scripture in the midst of times when we were told that the Scriptures were not for us, that perhaps this remnant, God's remnant people, perhaps there was something about the struggle that many of us have been in that God has been preparing us for a revolution in the church. And that perhaps there is no accident that the largest congregation of progressives in America happens to be in Dallas, Texas. Who would have thought of that? God certainly does continue to have a sense of humor. But that perhaps there is a place for Cathedral of Hope at this table but more than a place at the table, perhaps even leading the table. And so we gathered and we had a conversation. Now, we weren't all at the same place theologically. I consider myself to be progressive all the way over here. And there are others who consider themselves progressive not quite so over there. And in that room, there were also some folks who had been ministers in the Southern Baptist Convention and who were ministers in the Evangelical Church and who sat at that table with us. Now, most of those have made that journey to being open and affirming. And in the room also was Alan Chambers. Now, some of you will know that name. He was the founder and executive director of Exodus International. And many of you, I know, because I've heard some of your stories, have been through those programs that in your time were believing that you could not be a practicing homosexual and a Christian. As an aside, I think I've told you this before, but I've told people I'm no longer a practicing homosexual. I'm actually pretty good at it. Shouldn't encourage me like that. Alan Chambers led this group for many years. And many of the funerals that I have had to conduct have been because of a ministry like Exodus International. Young folks who couldn't reconcile these two pieces of their lives and who ultimately took their lives. I want to tell you, it was not easy sitting in the room with those who I have seen as an enemy. I'm going to tell you, it was the power of the Holy Spirit that convicted me to be there. And it was the power of the Holy Spirit that opened me wide enough in my own humanity, in my own weakness of the groanings of childbirth, that directed me to spend more time with Alan than anybody else in that room. I wanted to hear his story. I wanted to hear where the moments of intersection were in his life and in my life. Now, of course, Alan's taken pretty much a big journey and has renounced all of the work that he did in Exodus International, and for that we give thanks. But to sit in a room with him and to have conversation with him and to know that theologically we have been at very different places was only made real by the power of the Holy Spirit. I want to tell you what I discovered in my conversation was that he has been through as much pain as I have. Different pain, maybe some would say self-inflicted pain, but pain nonetheless. And that together we find a way through the midst to build a bridge to one another so that we no longer need to inflict such pain on anyone else. That's when Jesus says, "Peace be with you." That's when the power of the Holy Spirit shows up in its most beautiful and its most powerful. When we are able to build a bridge one with the other and to ultimately come to a place of peace and reconciliation. Not easy, but it's work that we must do together if we are truly to bring about a revolution of the Christian church so that it might be, as we would say in our statements, it might be radically inclusive. It can't just be us pointing a finger over here, knowing that they are pointing a finger back over here. There has to be a place, just as Jesus did with his disciples in preparation of his own death, to say, "Peace be with you," even though those around the table would deny him, persecute him, and betray him. You see, friends, that is the work of the Christian church, is to build those bridges of hope and transformation and to destroy the walls that would separate us. It's the work of Cathedral of Hope, and it's the work of the gospel of Jesus. In that room also was a minister, a pastor from an evangelical church, a very large evangelical church in Tennessee. He had a young man in his congregation come out to him and began a journey of his own theological study to assert what he believed around these issues of sexuality and faith. Remember, this was a large church. He did not need to go on this journey. He could have just repeated what he had learned in seminary or what he had heard from others, but he decided faithfully that he wanted to take this journey and to see where the Holy Spirit would take him. It took him on a journey he didn't expect it to go. And over some time, he journeyed from being this pretty conservative evangelical to being an open and affirming person. Well, as a Christian minister, what do you do with that? He stood before his church and he told his church that from next Sunday they were going to be an open and affirming congregation. Over the next 4 weeks, 80% of his congregation left. 80% of his congregation left. But he was so convicted by the power of the Holy Spirit that he did not change his mind. He did not waver on where the Spirit had taken him and is slowly rebuilding that congregation now as an evangelical, open and affirming congregation in Tennessee. Amen. That is the power of the Holy Spirit. And it's the power that we get to be a part of every single day, not just as an institution, not just as a denomination, not just as a congregation, but as individuals. When we're in the workplace, when we're in the line at the store, when we're trying to reconcile those in our own communities and families who have rejected us, when we try to reconcile and find peace with Scripture. You see, as Cathedral of Hope, we've had to find peace somewhere in our lives. And now for many of our evangelical sisters and brothers, they too are trying to find peace in their lives. The pastor said to me, I had to find peace because I'd been lied to by my church. I had to find peace because I'd been lied to by my seminary. I had to find peace with Scripture because I had been lied to by those who had authority and trained me to be a minister. And I want to tell you, sisters and brothers, I found a place of intersection with him because I too had been lied to. Lied to by previous denominations. Lied to by previous experiences. And regardless of where we are now theologically, progressive and evangelical, conservative, all of those names that we put out there, the power of the Holy Spirit comes amongst us, just individually and purposefully. And just like Jesus to his disciples says, peace be with you. My peace I leave with you. May we be bold enough, not in our humanity, but by the power of the Holy Spirit, to extend that peace beyond our borders and boundaries. Not easy work. I'm not saying that we should just go out there and today and say, love you all. Flower power, all of those good things. But that we should be with purpose and with power, bring peace to the world. Perhaps that's why God created us. To bring about a revolution so that in the pains of childbirth, as described in the book of Romans, we might find peace together. God bless you, Cathedral of Hope. May we be on this journey together, for it's a hard place to be. God bless you. Amen.
The presentation of the tithes and offerings is the part that I don't like because I have difficulty doing it. But Bless your heart, David, for giving it to me. And peace be with you. As members of God's holy family, we are blessed for all what God has done in our lives. So we are grateful for those blessings, and now it is our opportunity to share, praying that all the offerings given today are out of love. And we invite you to please register your attendance in the red books at the end of the pews. And we thank you for being generous and for supporting God's family. Thank you.
Yesterday, like many Saturdays at the Cathedral of Hope, there was a lot of activity. There was Dance with the Sun rehearsal happening in the Interfaith Peace Chapel. Preparations were being made for a wedding in the afternoon. The DIFA volunteers for their upcoming event were here for a meeting. Flowers were being put everywhere. Music was being practiced in other rooms, and we had a boot camp going on. And at the end of the camp, a young man came up to me and he said, "I moved here 10 months ago, my husband and I, and I'm from the UK. He said, "I never have experienced anything like this in my life. People are here just as they are, participating just as they want to participate, and feeling the love of God wherever they are and whatever they do. And I thought to myself, isn't that exactly what Jesus was saying on that night when he was betrayed, when he took bread and told us to eat, when he took the cup and said, I want you to drink, that everyone is welcome just as they are.
And let us pray. Almighty God, send the power of your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of grape and grain. Make them for us holy food that nurtures us in body and spirit, that by sharing this feast we may know the presence and power of the living Christ. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all of the world. Through Jesus Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory be yours, now and forever. Amen.
Come just as you are.
Thank you.
We thank you, God, for the gift of love, for the grace, and all the blessings that we have received today. But especially we thank you for loving us as a mother. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Friends, please take note of the flowers as they have been given this day. Remind you that there is a time of prayer following worship should you need a prayer for healing or for reconciliation. And of course, we extend a very special invitation to you to join us in the fellowship hall for a time of fellowship and friendship. And now, unto God's gracious mercy and protection, each and every one of us is given. And the blessing of God, known to us as Creator, Savior, and Holy Spirit, be with us and remain with us now and forevermore. Amen. Go in peace.